any other time, if it weren't for this flipping bug, I'd have just popped in the car and popped down to Marlow, and with a bit of luck, met the bloke in person and got fed, quite frankly. But we'll have to make do on Zoom instead, I'm afraid, Tom.
Yeah, sadly, I mean, we would love to be feeding you, but sadly, we're not allowed just yet. You know, we can feel that it's almost there, but we're not allowed just yet.
Getting there. I mean, whether you're a little pub, a Michelin star restaurant, what a nightmare this last year has been.
It has, yeah, it has been. It's been very, very difficult for the whole of hospitality. But, you know, for everybody, there's so many businesses that have been affected, you know, travel and tourism and airlines and, you know, just so many different businesses that have just not been able to operate. Live music, you know, performances, you know, sports, all of that sort of stuff, where anything that involves people hanging out together has pretty much been shut down. So, you know, it's not just hospitality. There's a lot of people that have had a very, very difficult year. But yeah, I mean, the industry that me personally I'm in is it's been particularly bumpy.
But what a great thing is people, there's positives out of all this. People adapt, they come up with new initiatives, I mean, all the takeaways and all that sort of thing, to try and make a living during all this mess.
Yeah, to be honest, I think the takeaway stuff, it's not really been about making a living, because I think everybody who's done it, whether it's pubs, restaurants, bars, anybody that's tried to do anything that where it, none of it makes money, because it can't, it just doesn't make sense. There's not the volume or the demand. But what it does do is it connects. And that's really important. It's staying connected to communities and society and people. And it's also giving people, your friends and work colleagues, opportunities to do something, to feel stimulated and be able to achieve something, so rather than just being sat at home. Because, you know, it isn't one of those jobs that you can move to being on a Zoom call. You know, you can't do Zoom hospitality. So it's been, everybody's adapted, has done it for not for profit and not for being able to stay alive, but have actually done it because it just keeps connection and that human interaction, which is everything that we're, it's the industry that we're in. So yeah, it's been good for people to be involved in, if no matter what business or area of hospitality they're in. If they've done something like that, it's more to do with keeping themselves busy and keeping society and people around them fed, and just staying within that community vibe and that reach.
Yeah, and I guess it sort of reminds everyone you're still there and what they're missing. You know, come back.
Yeah, do you know what? The one that if there's any positive to take out of it is the fact that hospitality, whereas before you could always still buy food from the supermarket, you can buy drink from the off license. You know, people are missing out on that. What they are missing out is the venues, the spaces, and what they provide in terms of, we do the washing up, we bring the food to you, we pour your pints, we do the, you know, and then we help create atmosphere and energy. And that has a value to it. And I think maybe this last year, for the first time ever, there's a lot of people would have now beginning to recognize that there's value, there's much more value in just what is the price of a pint of beer and how much you can buy a steak for. There's so much more to it now. And I think that's been a huge positive of this year, is that the industry has, or we hope will be, recognized as a true profession for people that create environment, space and enjoyment.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I do all my thinking, all my creativeness, all my chilling, just going for a quick drink on my own, Billy No Mates, a cup of coffee or something in a cafe or a pub or whatnot. And I am so missing that. But anyway, hopefully in a few weeks, we'll be back sort of almost getting there.
Yeah, we keep our fingers crossed, don't we?
So we're keeping our fingers crossed even more because of a summer where we'll hopefully be back to normal. Because the last few years you've been doing your pub in the park, haven't you? Which has been amazing. I don't know, people that aren't used to Marlow, Higginson Park, that's where it is, isn't it?
It is Higginson Park, right on the river.
Is just the gorgeous little park. An expanse of grass and an area right next to the river. It couldn't get any more sexier and lovelier venue, really.
No, it's magical. It's a beautiful space right on the river with Marlow Bridge in the background. The park is amazing. It's a beautiful space. It's like right in the heart of Marlow. And, you know, everybody who lives in and around the area knows it very well. It's a great place to, you know, visit, come for a walk, grab yourself a takeaway cup of coffee. You know, eat, through lockdown, it's been, I think it's been a godsend for so many people because that's where they've done, been able to do their exercise. It's been a great place where you've been able to take your kids. It's been, you know, it's proved this, it's proved the focal point of sanity, I think. So it's amazing that we can bring Pub in the Park back to it. Obviously last year all events and all festivals got cancelled, so it's been a very difficult year for us as a festival business, but it's been allowed us to be very excited about being able to get reopen and go again. And that energy and that vibe that everybody wants from Pub in the Park is still there. It still exists. In fact, it's probably the appetite for it is even bigger. And, you know, people come, they have food, lots of different chefs are turning up and cooking and doing demonstrations and being a part of being a part of amazing kind of dishes that people could come and eat, but also just hanging out, food producers, suppliers, the exhibitors that are showing kind of that, you know, like a lovely little shopping center. And then obviously musicians, and we finish it with great lineup, great acts. And again, you know, live music has been one of those industries that has been hit the same as restaurants. No one's been able to go to gigs. And, you know, we all talk about restaurants and we all firstly think of front of house staff and chefs. But actually there's much more to it. There's the supply chain, which is, you know, the butchers, the farmers, the fishermen, that sort of thing. And live music has had the same. You've got the roadies, the sound men, the tech guys, the all of that sort of, so all of these people, we've all been doing very little, you know, surrounding our own industries for a year. So it's great that we can, these are two industries now that are combined, wanting to get back out there and entertain and to hang out with people.
And it's great, and it's an outdoor venue and sit up, which I think will help a lot of people, because people are going to be a bit wary getting back into the normal and having it in such a lovely location. I mean, most pubs just stick a barbie on or do a pig roast, but you take it to a total level, new level. I mean, it's like the Chelsea Flower Show of sort of local produce.
We try to do it as best as we can. If you the level and the quality of chefs that we bring along, you know, most they're all my mates and they're all incredible cooks with brilliant restaurants themselves. So when they turn up, they want to do food that's a little bit more it's not necessarily what they do in the restaurant, but it is the flavors, the vibe, the energy that their restaurant provides. It's all kind of like street foodie style. It's all about, all the dishes are around about £6 a dish, and you know, you're able to wander around, eat bits and bobs of everybody. So they're not, it's not just like a massive main course. You can have something from everywhere, you can try stuff, hang out, and it does create this lovely, it's a family friendly brilliant kind of festival. You know, the fact that everyone's eating and being a part of the food scene, and then, you know, there's great drinks that offer in there, there are great bars, and there are that great environment with live music, but it kind of moves into that. It's not just an all-out boozy festival. It's much more user-friendly. It creates a great environment, eating, drinking, and then having a party at the end. It's like the ultimate night out.
And value for money, £6 for a Top Chef, not a bit of nosh. I've paid far worse than that for a skanky burger and a processed BAP.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, very true. For our point of view, our biggest thing that we want to do is make sure, actually, the biggest thing is organising it so that the chefs are involved, the people that are taking part in it, are having fun. So if all the guys behind the kitchens and behind the scenes are having a load of fun, it flows out into the park, into the festival. It means that people then are enjoying themselves, having a great time. So it creates this all-round vibe. And it's not about making loads of money. It's about creating an environment, particularly this year. We're trying to make sure that we can celebrate being outside as much as possible. We're also giving away 1,000 tickets. We're doing something called 1,000 thank yous, and we're doing it in every venue and every site that we go to, where we're giving 1,000 tickets away to the people that have been the most amazing during lockdown. So we're speaking to the local authorities and charitable trusts in the area. So it could be a load of nurses, it could be some charitable donations, it could be the local church, whoever volunteered, people that everyone in the area thinks deserves a thank you. So we're giving 1,000 tickets away in each site as well. So it tries to create a magical kind of environment of people having great fun and giving a little bit back as well, to say thank you so much to everybody who worked so hard over the last year. Come and have a bit of a party on us.
Oh, brilliant. I must say, hands up, I've not been to any of them yet, but I shall make the effort this year.
Yeah, well, Thursday night we got Ronan Keating playing. Friday we got Basement Jacks and Mark Howman. Saturday afternoon we got Craig Charles doing an amazing DJ set in Beverly Knight. Saturday evening we got Craig David with Marlow, which will be incredible. And then Sunday we've got Kareem Bailey Ray, who's an incredible kind of artist. She's brilliant. And then Sunday evening we've got Reef and Jack Savretti, which I mean it's an amazing lineup. So yeah, grab yourself a ticket or two.
That is brilliant. And tickets are available now, aren't they? And when is it and how do they get them?
Yeah, it's pubinthepark.uk.com for the website with all the details on it. And Marlow is the 16th to the 19th of September. And if you're around in the surrounding areas, there's St Albans and Warwick, and we're going into London. So there's 8 different venues. If you can't get into Marlow, there are different spaces we're doing it. But it's pubinthepark.uk.com for all ticket information.